evening, everyone. Can anybody see me, hear me in the back? A little bit shorter than Chaz. My name is Farah Mohsen. I usually introduce myself as Farah because it's easier for Americans to remember my name, as I refer to, like Farah Fawcett, only younger and prettier and alive. So. Too soon? I've been in the United States since 2008. I came here on a student scholarship to study at Dominican University in San Rafael, California. And I wanted to come here and study political science. Very ironic for Iraqi. It's not very unusual for an Iraqi to study politics or to talk about politics. But it's very ironic to study politics in America. And I purposely wanted to do that because I wanted to understand why my country was invaded. And even more so, I wanted to understand what democracy really meant, especially in the context of the United States coming to my country, kicking the door open forcefully, and shoving down democracy down the throats of my people. And I have learned a lot. I have seen a lot. And I have experienced a lot since I've been here. And one of the privileges, I guess, is to be able to be in a room like this and to be able to be an Iraqi, to deliver the stories and the testimonies and the reality of what has happened to Iraq after 2003, during and after 2003, and also to talk about Iraq before 2003. Because one of the many things that a lot of people forget is that Iraq have lived a very, very harsh time before the invasion. And the harsh time that Iraqis lived is not just because of Saddam Hussein's dictatorship, but it was also the dictatorship of the economic sanctions because of the surveillance, surveillance planes that flew over Iraq, the sudden bombings that happened every now and then. One of the military actions that took place actually in Iraq in 1998 was Desert Fox, that happened during the Clinton administration that a lot of people really praise and say it was one of the good administrations during the American contemporary or modern history, and it's actually not. So I feel very privileged to be here in this room. And like what Chaz said, there is hope. But before I start off, I actually received an email today about something tragic that has happened due to the newly installed democracy in Iraq. And I just want to read to you that this is how democracy has been translated to my country. And I'll go into detail in a little bit, but I just want to read to you the timeline of what has happened in Hawija, which is a village near Kirkuk. On April 21st, the Brussels Tribunal, which is a peaceful think tank and peace organization, it's an activist think tank and peaceful organization. On April 21st, they received and published the following communication from Iraq. 4,000 peaceful protesters in Hawija are now surrounded by government army troops and are about to be attacked. They have been surrounded by these troops for the past 3 days without water, food, and medical aid. Friday, protesters were attacked, one killed and four injured. Medical treatment was withheld. On Saturday, government troops stormed the field of protest and destroyed all the kitchen facilities as well as the medical facilities. Roads leading to the field were cut off. Save the peaceful Iraqi revolution, save the 4,000 men and children in Hawija. Now, this was on April 21st. On April 23rd, General Ali Ghaydan Majid, the Iraqi Land Forces commander, openly threatened all protesters anywhere in Iraq that he is authorized and determined to take serious actions against the demonstrators on the pretext that they are terrorists and Ba'athists. He claimed that his troops are protecting the demonstrators while the demonstrators themselves are suffering from the unacceptable repression by the armed forces. Now, the Brussels Tribunal continued to say that their newsletter came too late and at least 38 lives are lost. A few hours ago, 38 people have died. Probably the number has gone higher right now, but I don't know at this point. However, just to give you a little example of what has happened in Iraq, or what's happening in Iraq today, after the troops withdrew, after the media has, and the American administration has publicly announced that the war in Iraq is over. The war is not over. When you place a government that is corrupt, when you place a government that is clinging to power and sucking on the blood of the Iraqi people and sucking on its oil, sending 80% of its oil to foreign investing companies to go and invest outside of Iraq, export 80% of the oil outside of Iraq, leaving only 20% for the Iraqi people to live on, to help them continue on with the simplest needs that they need for gas, for electricity, for anything, to starve them to death, to survive 4,000 innocent protesters just because of the simple fact that they are demanding their right, because they want their voices to be heard, to be falsely accused that they're Baathists just because they're Sunni. What kind of a justice is that? What kind of a democracy is that? So that's one light I could shed, but there are many. The other thing I want to talk about is I want to take you a little bit back in time and talk about Iraq before the war. And this is a personal story. The harsh economic sanctions that is often forgotten in the mainstream media and also in the American public really forget about, and how its consequences were severe, and actually they still continue till this day. But I want to talk about a personal story, a personal testimony. My father had severe illnesses. He had severe asthma and he had severe heart problems. And one of the medications that he needed for him to survive, in order for him to survive, was the Ventolin inhaler. Some of you might be familiar with it. So it basically helps ease down the tension or the congestion in the chest and allows for the patient to be able to breathe. And it was very hard for him to get that we used to beg our friends or any family members that left Iraq to Jordan. We paid them thousands of Iraqi dinars, about hundreds of American dollars to be translated in our terms today, to get us to buy us at least one that will try and sustain him for 1 month or 2 months. My father didn't make it. He passed away in 1998 because he couldn't find enough medication to sustain him. The hospitals were not equipped enough to help sustain a person with severe problems like my father, with chronic illnesses. And all of that because the economic sanctions that were imposed on Iraq determine what kind of medication would come into Iraq and what kind of medication doesn't. And apparently Ventolin was one of the few medications that were prevented to come into Iraq because it was feared that Iraq might use it to create weapons of mass destruction. How could a medicine that helps a person, a patient, breathe, be used to create weapons of mass destruction? My father died at age 50. He didn't live enough to see his 11 grandchildren or to see me and my sisters graduate from universities and colleges and high schools. So that's one personal testimony to tell you about what has Iraq been through before the invasion. But then Iraqis, some of them, were hopeful that this invasion will bring a democracy, will probably open up the sanctions, will probably open up the market, that Iraqis will finally find the medication that they needed, will finally find the food that they were starving for. But no, instead they're faced with a corrupt government that was helped to be placed in Iraq with the help of the United States. There's a book that I really urge you to read, and I know it's probably not written by the best people, but still, it's called The End Game, and honestly, I forgot the authors, but they're two former members of the military, but they have done extensive research on Iraq post the invasion. one of these sections that they discussed, which is selecting the government in Iraq, they said that Zalmay Khalilzad, the Iraqi the American ambassador to Iraq, he chose two people to run for the elections. And he was asked to choose people that are quote-unquote eligible enough to rule Iraq. And these two people ought to be Shia, because Iraq is majority Shia. And one of them was Nouri Kamal al-Maliki. And he reported back to Donald Rumsfeld. You know what Donald Rumsfeld said in response? He said, "I don't care which one you pick, just pick one." And so he picked Nouri Kamal al-Maliki for various reasons, which I will not get into because it will take me forever. "I don't care which one you pick, just pick one." He picked the most corrupt leader that Iraq had ever witnessed. One of my Iraqi refugee friends said that back then we had one dictator, today we have 1,000 dictators. 1,000 dictators. Now I can, again, go into a lot of the issues that Iraqis and Iraq is going through today, but unfortunately we don't have enough time. But I do want to say one thing. I recently found this quote by Nelson Mandela, and it reads, "If you want to make peace with your enemy, you have to work with your enemy, then he becomes your partner." And once upon a time, people like me, myself, I thought of American people as my enemies because of what I saw during the invasion and what I saw after the invasion and what I still see today. But today, working with Iraq Veterans Against the War, I see partners in peace, truly partners in peace. And luckily, members of Iraq Veterans Against the War have managed to partner with Iraqi organizations to work towards that direction, and also to hold the United States government accountable for the human cost of war. And the human cost of war, not just because of this war that happened, but because of Desert Storm, because of what happened after Desert Storm, and because of what happened with Operation Liberation, or Operation Iraqi Liberation, which I will continue to call it that because it was purposely named that for the oil, if everybody remember that. So yeah, so we are standing together. We are holding the United States government, we are holding Bush, we're holding Cheney, we're holding Rumsfeld, we're holding everybody else, we're holding them accountable for everybody, for every innocent soul that has died, for every child, every woman, every man, for my father, for my cousins that were killed in Iraq after the invasion, for everybody, for me, for leaving, to be forced to leave my country because I'm a woman and because I'm not entitled to be living in my country anymore. Because according to the new militias that were sent by Iran to rule Iraq, I'm not allowed to be in my country anymore. So thank you very much for the democracy. Thank you very much for giving me the liberation. That's it. Thank you.